Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord God, that you brought us back together for the second half of the Victorious Spiritual Warfare Manual. And this is the part where we learn how to create a spirit of victory over another. We've learned how to be victorious. Now, Lord God, we learn to bring victory for another, which, Lord God, is my only goal, is to make other people victorious. That's my only hope, my only prayer, Lord God. Let it be yours in Jesus' name. God, we thank you. We ask that you would be with us tonight, that you would be with the speaker, be with the hearer. Let your Holy Spirit manifest. Let the demonic spirits flee. In Jesus' name, Lord, decrease me as you increase in me. In Jesus' name, I thank you and praise you and give you glory. In Jesus' name, mighty name, amen, amen, amen. All right, what's up? How y'all feeling out there? Did you miss a brother from another mother? Yep, I know you did. You missed the sound of my voice and the look on my face. I know that's true. I miss you too. So, this has been fellowship in the body, in the members that have been being fed by the tendons and the muscles and the blood vessels that flow from God through me into you, and through Christ Jesus, you are victorious. Actually, it's not my words that don't return void. It's the word of God that I preach. And the good news about me is I say what God said so much, people actually think that it's me. It's funny. Like, oh, why did you say that? Suppose you think you're always right. Nope. God's always right. And I always say what God said to say. Oh, why did you do that? I suppose you think you're Mr. Know-It-All. Nope. God is Mr. Know-It-All. And I just do what I see the Father doing. Did you know they didn't like Jesus? Guess what he did? Guess. I'm thirsty, so I'm taking an early break. What did Jesus do while he was on this earth? I'm going to help you out. I only do what I saw my Father doing. I only say what I hear my Father say. Who said that?
Jesus.
Jesus said that. I only do what I see my spiritual, when I see my brother is Jesus Christ, my Father is God Almighty. So I only do what the Holy Spirit provokes me to do, assigns me to do. That's all I do. And they didn't like what Jesus said and did.
Excuse me. Sorry.
Is there any squirrels over there?
No, I moved the squirrel.
Did you move the squirrel? Yes. What happened to the squirrel?
He's over there now.
Amen. Amen.
Sorry.
How you doing, Reverend Sally?
I'm doing good. I'm doing great. I'm doing awesome.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
How's that feel?
It feels great, good, and awesome.
You like apples?
Yes.
How you like them apples?
I love them apples.
A lot of times when you go to get your tooth pulled, it's uncomfortable. I ain't gonna lie. It's uncomfortable. You gotta go sit down in a chair, and some guy sticks his hand inside your mouth with rubber on his hands and digs around and pulls your tongue up and sticks a big, long, gigantic ass needle in your mouth, shoots Novocaine all in your mouth. What does he think's happening before the Novocaine takes hold? Is what I always wondered. Shoots Novocaine in the side up there in your lip, in your side of your cheek, in the muscle in the back, down in the root, and you're like, all the time you're uncomfortable, but you know what you do? Guess what you do? Everything he says to do. Every single thing. Open your mouth. Ah, stick out your tongue. Stick it to the other side. Hold it down. You do whatever he says to do. And it's an uncomfortable, terrible experience. Until when?
until all the pain is gone and the tooth is fixed. And
see what I'm saying? You went to the dentist on purpose because there was something the matter. You're sitting in front of me on purpose because there's something the matter. I'm in the house on purpose because something's the matter. I'm in that church on purpose because something was the matter. I'm the guy that extracts teeth, puts stitches in, bandages to set your leg. If your leg is broke, it hurt when it broke, but it don't hurt anymore until when? Guess. Who knows? Bambi knows. I know Bambi knows. Until you try to set it. And then when you go to set it, which means put it back in its rightful place, it hurts worse than it did when it broke. Who knows that's true? Does anybody know that's true on there? Y'all better talk to me on this second half, or I'm not going to do it. Y'all better say something to a brother. Let me know you're there. Because here's the deal. Here's the deal. It breaks, snaps. Now you got a broken leg. And here I come along, and it's broken. Part of your body is broken. There's something broken about you. And it's broken. I know it's broken. I'm looking at it, and it's broke. You think, well, maybe it ain't broken. I'm saying, oh, nah, yeah, baby, it's broke. Yeah, buddy, it's broke. Yeah, son, it's broke. Yeah, daughter, it's broke. I'm telling you in your face, yep, it's broke. I'm going to have to set it. Do you know what it means to set your leg or to set your arm? You know what that means? Guess what that means. Who knows what it means, Reverend? To put it back in its rightful place. Set, I got to set your leg. That means I've got to grab a hold of it, pull it, adjust it, and then put it back in its rightful place so that it can heal. What's the right word for heal? Heal what? Heal properly. So that it can heal properly. Because if I don't do a good job in the brokenness and in the demonic attack, if I don't do a good job, it will heal, but it won't heal properly. It'll be off kilter. Does that make any sense?
Yes.
If the dentist goes to fix your tooth and he drills the hole and then he lets you walk away, did he fix your tooth properly? No. He's got a process. You got to go through the process. If you don't go through the process, you won't get the product you're looking for. You add a little baking soda to a little bit of... Okay, never mind. That's a whole different process. Never mind. Never mind. Don't forget about the baking soda and the hot water and the ice cube and the coffee pot. Don't do that. But I'm trying to make a point. You have to go through the process. If you go through the process, you'll get promoted. If you don't go through the right process, you'll never get promoted because your leg was not set properly. So it's healing improperly. Your tooth wasn't fixed properly. So you go home and you bite into an apple or you drink an ice cold drink, ice water or something, and then you feel it and then bam, it hurt it all over again. And it didn't bother you, it didn't bother you, it didn't bother you, it didn't bother you. And then you eat some ice cream and you put the ice cream in your mouth and guess what happens? Yes. What happens, Reverend? You feel that pain shoot in that nerve and it goes straight up to the roof of your, right up into your brain. But you know what? But you didn't even know that that was going to happen until you did what?
Bit down on it.
Until you bit down on an apple or you put the spoon of ice cream in your mouth. You thought it was fine until you found it wasn't fine. That was the first half of Victorious Spiritual Warfare, teaching you how to properly set things so that they heal properly. Because there's people all around the world that are healing improperly, and they don't know that they healed improperly. You know what? I know a guy who used to high jump with me. This is a true story. His name is Jim Sampson. He used to high jump with me, and when he high jumped one time, he used to do the Western roll, and I did the Fosbury flop. So, and then he high jumped one time, and he broke his femur. Is that the bottom part of the leg down in here? Down in here? It was the femur. I think that's where it is. It's down in there behind the leg bone. I think it's the femur. So anyways, he broke a bone in the back. He broke it. So then he went to the doctor. The doctor didn't even think it was broke. He thought it was sprained. He put an ACE bandage on and told him to come back in 6 weeks. Well, in 6 weeks, guess what had happened? Yes. It had started to heal. It was healing. It already had bone marrow, whatever that is that forms around the break. And the doctor took the x-ray and said, yeah, well, it's going to be fine. It'll be good enough. I want to say that word again. I want you to pay attention to the story. He said, oh, it'll be good enough. Well, enough for what? So the whole year went by. We played basketball through that season. We ran cross country first. We played basketball that season. We came into the spring and track and field was starting to come back into full swing. And Jim went out there, I think it was probably the second or third track meet, and he went to jump and he planted his leg. Guess what happened? What are you doing now? Why are you cleaning up while I'm doing stuff? What is your... And you're worried about the stove.
I'm trying to organize.
All right, ready?
Yes, I'm listening.
Okay, so he went out. He went out the second or third meet. We already been through practice in that. Second or third meet, I can't remember which one. I think we were in Hinkley. And he went to jump. And I think we had scratched until about 6 feet. We were both very good high jumpers. So he went to jump, and when he planted his foot, guess what happened? Guess. Who knows what happened?
He broke his leg.
His leg broke again. Now, he had ran cross country because the doctor said it's good enough. Guess what was good enough for? It was good enough for cross country. And then we played basketball. The doctor said, he looked at the x-ray, the doctor said, oh, that's good enough. Guess what was he good enough for? It was good enough for basketball. So then spring came and we went back out for track. And then he went to plant his foot to jump.
Oof.
And guess what happened? All over again.
Snap.
Snapped his leg right in half again. Went down on the ground. Bone came through the back of his leg. Guess what the doctor was? The doctor said it was good enough. Well, it was good enough for cross country. It was good enough for basketball. Guess what it wasn't good enough for? It wasn't good enough for what he needed to have it good for. He needed it good. He needed it fixed. He didn't need it good enough. And a lot of times people are going into ministries and they're going into different situations and they're experiencing different things. And it's good, but it's not good enough for where God wants to take you. I hear you, a pastor. Was that a great story?
Mm-hmm.
Could you repeat it back to me?
Kind of, sort of. Not in your words.
So it was good enough, but it wasn't good. It was good enough. And a lot of times, you think that you're better, but you're not better enough. You think you're good? Yeah, you all right? Yeah, I'm good. Yeah, I'm good. But guess what you're not?
No.
You're not good enough. You're not good. You're good enough. You're good enough for what you're going through, but you're not good. Because if you were good, every circumstance that came up, you would still be what?
Good.
Good. But if you're only good enough, you're only good enough for the thing that you're good enough for. Guess what will always come from Satan and his demonic host? The thing that you need to be good. You need to be God. You need to be Holy Spirit. You need to be you need to be right there where you in the sweet spot. You don't need to be good enough. You need to be good, because if you're only good enough, when that crap comes, guess what's going to happen? Pop goes the weasel. All hell's going to break loose because you're good enough, but you're not good. You're only good enough. Is anybody getting this? Stare at that thing and see if anybody's saying anything.
Not right now.
Well, somebody say something, because this is pretty dang good stuff. I'm preaching good. I'm preaching way better than you are shouting. I ain't heard an amen or a hallelujah. Preach! Preach! Preach, Bishop! Preach! My God, you're good! Yeah, I ain't heard none of that. So, put some hearts, stars, pretzels, whatever you throw up there. Do that. Do that. Because I don't want you to be good enough. I don't want you to be all right. I don't want you to be okay. I'm going to ask Reverend Sally, see if she remembers what she said. I bet you $5. Oh, where are you going?
Just shutting the door.
Oh. Listen. Here we go. Ready? When we first came on, what did I say? How you doing? What did you say?
Tonight?
No, last month.
I said good.
And what else?
Great. Awesome.
Yeah. See? So here's the thing, right? Here's the thing. That's the answer. That's the answer. Blessed and highly favored. That's what you are. You're good, awesome, perfect. I'm the perfected finished work of Jesus Christ. You gotta know that. Because it doesn't do you any good for me to know that, because I'm not gonna be there when you get in the fight. That you're going to have to know whether or not you did this right or not. Because if you didn't do it right, you're going to get your ass whooped. And now I'm taking you into a place to where not only do I need you to be on point and amazing and good and awesome, I need you to be highly favored and anointed of God. I need you to start saying the things that this paperwork says. I need you to start saying that. Matter of fact, it's been a long time since I did it, so I'm going to do it right now. You ready? Ready? Everybody get your paper and read with me. I'm going to start. Ready? On your mark, you want to get your paper before I start?
I got it.
Okay, you ready?
Mm-hmm.
You ready to start?
Yep.
You got your glasses. Do you have everything you need?
Yes.
All right, you ready? I am God's child. I am Christ's friend. I have been justified. I can't hear you. I have been justified. I am united with the Lord and I am one spirit with him. Are you going to read along?
I am.
Out loud.
Okay.
I am united with the Lord and I am one spirit with him. I have been bought with a price. Right. I belong to God. I am a member of Christ's body. I am a saint. I have been adopted as God's child. I have direct access to God through His Holy Spirit. I have been redeemed and forgiven of all my sins. I am free forever from condemnation. I am assured that all things work together for good. I am free from any condemning charges against me. I cannot be separated from the love of God. I have been established, anointed, and sealed by God. I am hidden with Christ in God. I am confident that the good work that God has begun in me will be perfected. I am a citizen of heaven. I have not been given a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. I want to stop right there for a minute. Reverend Sally did this the other day, and I hadn't really thought about it until she said it. And the truth is, I've been doing this since about 1991, and I never realized it. She said this the other day when she was doing her testimony. She said, I have not been given a spirit of fear, but a power. So the spirit of fear is a spirit, right? But follow that through. Spirit of power, spirit of love, and spirit of a sound mind. When she did that, she actually blessed me because I never took it into the next three things as spirits.
Mm.
You see what I'm saying? I read spirit of fear and that the spirit was just a fear. But that's not how it reads in grammatic language.
Right.
Where am I at? It says, I have not been given a spirit of fear, but of spirit of power, spirit of love, and spirit of... It doesn't say spirit of power, spirit... But that's how that grammatically, grammar, mm-hmm. That's how it really should say. I've been not given a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. Those are spirits also. Spirits come from where?
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit. The other spirit of fear comes from where?
Demonic.
It's demonic. All right, I'm in Hebrews 4:16.
Okay.
I can find grace and mercy in time of need. I am born of God, and the evil one cannot touch me. I'm going to stop right there. 1 John 5:18. I am born of God. Are you born of God, Reverend Shelley? Then guess what? Then the evil one cannot what?
Touch me.
The evil one can what?
Not touch me.
So if the evil one shows up, what does that mean?
He cannot touch
me. He cannot touch you. So if he cannot touch, listen, family, friends, and fans, if the evil one cannot touch you, then why are you rattling around and rolling around and screaming and hollering and fussing and fighting? Why, if the evil one cannot touch you, how is he touching you? Either this is true or it's a lie and I'm full of shit. I promise you, this isn't a lie and I'm not full of shit. Because I mean what I say and I say what I mean. All this is from the Bible. It says the evil one cannot touch you. I can find grace and mercy in time of need. So when you get it, when you get into a needy place, guess what you should find?
I don't know, Pastor Danny, I didn't take that class.
Grace and mercy. Grace and mercy. When do you find grace and mercy? In good times? Is that what it says? No. It says you'll find grace and mercy in time of need. Okay, well, you don't have to like it if you don't want to. I am born of God. Here we go. And the evil one cannot touch me. And the evil one can't touch you. So even if the evil one shows up, guess what?
Cannot touch you.
Cannot touch you. Can the evil one touch me?
Nope.
Can the evil one touch Reverend Sally?
Nope.
Can the evil one touch Pastor Dave Carlson?
Nope.
Can the evil one touch Mary?
Nope.
Can the evil one touch Holly?
Nope.
Okay, do you know why I'm so aggressive? Because the evil one cannot touch me. I flow like a butterfly, sting like a bee. I'm a spiritual superhero. I am a spirit. You guys think that Buzz Lightyear and what was the cowboy in the Buzz Lightyear show? Woody.
Woody, yeah.
You guys think Woody and Buzz Lightyear are really superheroes. You really run around with Buzz Lightyear shirts on. You guys really think that Yoda is a superhero. You really believe that shit. You really believe that shit. You really believe Spider-Man is a superhero. You believe that shit. You even teach your kids that shit and get them pajamas with that shit on there. You know what the next pair of pajamas your kids should get?
Jesus.
Is a picture of me on a pair of pajamas. I'm a spiritual superhero. You don't have to like it. It's still true. I'm going to be in Matthew 5:13. If you got to go to do your stuff, I'll let you go. I mean, on the board.
No, I'm fine.
You're good? Okay. I am significant. Okay. I am the salt and the light of the earth. I am a branch of the true vine and channel of his life. I have been chosen and appointed to bear fruit. I am a personal witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. I am God's temple. If you don't just get excited when you read 1 Corinthians 3:16, I'm not even going to say I right now because I'm so narcissistic. I already know I'm all that. I already know I'm all that. I'm all that. I want you to know something right now. Guess what I want you to know? You have been chosen and appointed to bear fruit. You are a personal witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. You are God's temple. You are God's co-worker. You are God's workmanship. You may approach God with freedom and confidence. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Change it. Make sure you identify yourself in this. Because when I read I'm so confident I think that you're being quiet. I really do. Reverend Sally does it all the time. As soon as my mouth starts moving, everybody in the room shuts up. I feel bad about that. You know what I wish? When I start talking, you know what I wish? Everybody else would rejoice with me. I would. You know, I want everybody to know that who they are in Christ Jesus. Because if this is true and you're under enemy attack, then who's the victor? You or the enemy? Who's the victor? You're the victor. When you come into a confrontation against the demonic foe, I don't even care if you don't even want to call it the devil. If you're in a grocery store and somebody's obnoxious, rude, and you're greater is he that is in you than he that is in that person acting obnoxious and rude and asinine. Even if it's with your husband, greater is he that is in you than he is in that behavior that he's exhibiting. Even if it's your teacher or your professor or your boss at work, don't even trip. You know how many times I've pushed people down just so they would learn how to fall? This is a true story. I got to tell you a story. I used to teach martial arts in Cottonwood, Arizona. Dylan was in the class, and he had instructors, and they were good, really good, and I'm really strong. I mean, like deadly. But those guys were very artistic and very poetic in their moves and stuff. So one day, one of the instructors said, "Would you take the class and teach them how to fall down?" Why did they ask me to do that? Why in the world would anybody ask Danny Barnes, "Would you teach these young men how to fall down?"
Oh my goodness.
Who thought that was a good idea? So I walked up to the kid and I said, "Step forward." I put both my hands like this and I shoved him. And he fell down. I got through about 15 kids before the instructor could run over there. Pastor Barnes, what are you doing? What are you doing? I said, "I'm teaching them how to fall down." Well, you gotta be careful and gentle. You can't just, really? Do you think the person that's coming up to them with a board or a stick or a brick or a punch is gonna be soft and gentle and nice? If you want them to learn, I'm gonna teach them. First thing you do when you want to learn about falling down is what? Don't be there when the punch comes. Don't be there when the shove comes. Is it better to learn how to fall down, or is it better to learn to stay away from falling down? I'm going to just ask a question. Y'all can answer for yourself. That instructor couldn't stand me, but guess what he couldn't do? He couldn't whoop me either. You know why? Because he had very beautiful, poetic motions. You know what I had? I had a knockout punch that ring your bell.
Ring your bell.
Okay, sorry, I got off on a tangent. But you see what I'm saying? I was teaching them boys that life is tough and people that are fighting them are tough. And if they, first thing is defend yourself. They were standing there like this, waiting for Mr. Barnes to push them down. What damn fool thought that was a good idea? Just standing there waiting for Mr. Barnes. Yeah, and Mr. Barnes is going to teach you how to fall. Nope, I'm going to teach you how not to get shoved down. Because it's going to hurt. Guess what you're going to avoid next time. All right, that's Taekwondo Unlimited. Cottonwood, Arizona. It's a really good school. If you happen to be in Cottonwood, Arizona, go to Taekwondo Unlimited. They're a very good, very good school. Kind of soft. Okay, so listen. In a spiritual warfare, what I train people to do is I train them to be aggressive and not receptive. Most people wait for an enemy attack to defend themselves. You know what I teach people to do? How not to get caught up in an enemy attack. Wow, I did really well. Yeah, but you were still under attack. How about you get to the place where you're not under attack? How about you get to the place where whatever's said, whatever's done, however, it don't faze you? How about if somebody drops a glass of water and you don't lose your mind? How about if somebody leaves us, wonder if something happens and you just make up your mind that you're not going to be moved by whatever it is that came up? Just don't be moved. Because otherwise the devil will know that you're easily distracted, and guess what he'll do? We used to do this when we were young. You know what I used to tell people all the time? I say, me and I used to get in fights with like Kevin Moore. I used to get in fights with him. You know what I always do? I'd always look right past the shoulder and go, "Watch out, Kevin." Guess what Kevin would do every time? Guess. Told him what? Guess what happened when he would turn back around?
You punch him.
I punch him as hard as I could in the face. Kevin fell for it every single time. And most people do. "What's that?" And they turn around and look. Guess what you can't be when you're in a spiritual battle? You can't be distracted. I'm actually trying to teach you some stuff that'll not just save you, but it'll save. When I'm driving the car, guess what I don't worry about? Yes. What other people are doing while they're driving. You want to know why? They drive their car, I'll drive my car. I'm going to make sure that I'm in a good place. And they can run into the wall if they want to. I ain't even paying attention. I'll slam on my brakes because somebody else slammed on their brakes. I don't run into a ditch just because they ran. You ever get on a freeway and it's got them two white lines that come into a V, and you're coming off the off ramp, and then there's cars like for about 5 miles trying to get over in the lane because they don't want to cross a white line. Does it say anywhere in the driver's manual that you can't cross a white line? They stay in that lane, and there's all kinds of room, and they're waiting to get to the end of that peak of that white line to cross over. As soon as I come off that off ramp, if there's a way to get over, zoom, I'm all the way over, and I'm so far going down the freeway, by the time they get going, it's not even funny. It doesn't seem like a big deal, right? But you know what everybody else is? Stuck in traffic. You know what I'm not? Stuck in traffic. You know, in the church, people are stuck in their behavior, in their thought process. You know what I'm not? Stuck. People get stuck in people's opinions of them. You know what I'm not? Stuck in people's opinions of me. People get stuck in what happened with their dad or their mom or when they were a child. And you know what? If you haven't suffered sexual abuse when you were a child, you are a miracle right there. Because everybody I know, including myself, was sexually molested, abused, or physically abused, emotionally, whatever. Beat with boards, crowbar, sticks, razor straps, extension cord. That's a common dang thing in America. Americans beat the shit off their children. That's what the hell Americans do. Because they're proud to be an American where they can beat their kids to death. Okay, I got off on another tangent. But here's what I'm trying to tell you. I'm not stuck in them places. People are stuck on the D they got on their third grade report card. People are stuck on the fact that the babysitter touched them inappropriately. People are stuck because they got sent to the principal's office in the fifth grade. People are stuck that their mama didn't put their damn stupid ass color crayon picture on the refrigerator when they brought the picture up. Stuck. They're 45 years old, stuck, because their mama didn't put a daggone picture of a turkey on the refrigerator that you made in the third grade, Ethel. Can you imagine how you see how that's a spiritual attack? Robbed you of your identity over a turkey paste thing that you did, or the girl that you gave a Valentine's due to in the third grade didn't like your Valentine's because you couldn't spell Tammy. You big dummy. No wonder she didn't like you. You can't spell. No, I'm just kidding. But what I'm saying is you see how people got stuck? They're still getting stuck today. Something somebody says, they're still stuck. Something somebody does. Well, you sound just like my dad. Where's your dad? Well, he's dead. How long has he been dead? 42 years. Your dad's been dead for 40 years and you still are worried about what he said? That, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, family, friends, and fans, is not victorious spiritual warfare. That's the opposite of victorious spiritual warfare. Victorious spiritual warfare is whatever happened, happened, and it's gone and done. And as far as the east is from the west, it's gone. Thrown into, according to the Bible, thrown into the sea of forgetfulness. Do you understand what I'm telling you? I want you to be free, because who the Lord says free is free indeed. And then because you're free now, I want to teach you this other class right here. How long have I been talking? An hour?
40 minutes.
Okay, I'm gonna teach you now. I taught you how to be free. Are you free? I'm gonna take a drink, and I want you to let me know if you're free. Are you free? Because if you're free, then I want to teach you how to. To speak into other people's lives so they can be free. And if you're struggling with any of those things that I just mentioned, do you know how long you have to struggle with them? Here's what a struggle looks like. Ready? Ready? Everybody ready? Okay. Here's what a not struggle looks like. Let it go. You were touched inappropriately? Let it go. You weren't spoken to quite right when you... Let it go. You weren't appreciated? Let it go. Somebody cheated on you? Let it go. Somebody died in your life important to you? Let it go. Let it go. Everybody talking about they're giving things to God, but they got a chain wrapped around it with a master padlock on it, anchor holding on. All right, God couldn't get it from you. Let it go. Let it go. And when you stop talking about negative stuff, it'll take you a minute or two, but you'll think of other things to talk about. I was talking to a dear friend of mine the other day. I said, I wonder what we would talk about if we weren't talking about that. I wonder what we, it was a pastor friend of mine, I wonder what we would talk about if we weren't talking bad about that person. What would we talk about if we weren't talking bad about our husband? What would we talk about if we weren't talking bad about our wife? What would we talk about if we weren't talking bad about the politicians? What would we talk about? Maybe we would talk about God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, the love of God, the freedom, the joy, the peace. Because see, if we don't learn that the things we've been talking about have never benefited us, you gotta be able to start talking about something else. And that brings me to this place that I want to be. All right. Everybody knows that I'm proud of Reverend Sally. And if you don't know that, you should have read my post that said, if you come up against a kingdom couple and you speak poorly about their wife, that might not be a good idea. All right. Here it is. Women on Fire presents Reverend Sally Clark, March 7th at 3:30. At the Josiah Center at 1600 Jarvis Avenue, Maplewood, Minnesota. And you need to be there, even if you got to take an Uber or what is that thing called, the little bus where it take people, Care Ride.
Metro Ride.
No matter how you got to get there, you need to be there. Women especially, this should be girl code, you know, like fight night, MMA stuff, that's guy code, we're going. If one of my buddies, Derek, is the MMA fighter, if Derek was going to go fight, or my son Dylan, he's a martial artist, that's guy code, we're going to go support him and see him fight. This should be girl code. Women everywhere should support Reverend Sally. Because as you support, as you sow, you shall also reap. As you support the woman of God, you will be supported. As you sow into her, you will be sowed into. As you bless her, you will be blessed. This should be girl code, like how y'all trade blouses and scarves and hair. I don't know what you exchange anymore. I haven't been around women that much anymore. But I know you guys used to just be able to wear each other's anything. Earrings. Can I wear that blouse? Yeah, but men don't do that. Well, men from my generation don't do that. Alright, so if you want an invitation to this, get on there and ask for one. When I say get on there, I mean type it into your phone to where she can see it. The other thing I want you to know is invite other people. Everybody you know should know that on March 7th, Reverend Sally Clark is going to break the back of the devil and teach women how to be free and how to walk in victory. And I don't care if you made it to the grocery store, you can make it there. If you made it to the doctor's appointment, you can make it there. If you made it to the hairdresser, you can make it there. If you made it to work, you can make it there. I don't care, call in sick, call in crazy, call in whatever you want to call in. Women need to fill that building up and hear a testimony that doesn't end in someday my life is going to be better. I am sick and damn tired of hearing people waiting on heaven when it's available to you right here on earth. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Don't be mad I said it. Be mad you didn't understand. All right, here we go. It says, Lighthouse, this is the beginning. I'm in. Did I already read the thing? I got to read the scripture. I'm sorry I took so long on that. No, I'm not. It says, he that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Wherefore I say unto you, this is Jesus in Matthew 12, 31. Wherefore I say unto you, did you hear what I said? Matthew 12, 31. I know you like to type that in. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. And whoever shall speak a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him. Neither in this world, neither in the world to come. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and its fruit corrupt. For the tree is known by his fruit. O generation of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speak. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things. An evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you, every idle word that a man shall speak, they shall give an account therein in that day of judgment. For by the words thou shalt be justified, and by the words thou shalt be condemned. Now, the part I want to stand on right here, and I read this recently, but the part I want to stand here right here, is I want to stand on the fruit. You judge a behavior, an action, by its fruit. If you're going through something at work, and you think it's an awful, terrible situation, but don't move, stay still. And then at the end of that, you find yourself being promoted and get a raise or get an area of authority greater than you had. Then what was the fruit of the confrontation or the conflict? What was the fruit? Don't judge a tree until it has fruit. You can't judge a tree by its seed. All seeds look pretty much the same. Now, I know Reverend Sally's a gardener, and she might be able to tell different kinds of seeds from that. But I'm telling you, the average eye, a seed looks like a seed. But listen, careful now. If you sow the seed, don't judge it, the seed, until it starts producing fruit. When you see the fruit, you'll know if that seed was sown in a good ground and that tree developed good fruit. But you can't judge a tree by its seed. You got to judge a tree by its fruit. And you got to do this. Don't judge your marriage in the middle of a storm. Judge your marriage by the fruit that is produced in the course of time. Don't judge your job by a bad day at work. Judge your job by the fruit that it produces. Don't judge your car by the fact that it broke down and had a flat tire. Did you ever get rid of your car because it had a flat tire? But you get rid of your husband and he got a flat tire. He's not rolling real good. He's not doing. And 18, 20, 18, 18 months, 18 years, whatever, you judge the tree by its fruit. What was produced by what I said and did? What was accomplished by what came out of my mouth? What? Judge the fruit. You got the fruit in your hand. It's available to you. Look at the fruit and ask yourself, is this good fruit? Then I'm a good tree. Is it bad fruit? Then I'm a bad tree. But don't judge me by how I talk, my eyebrows up. You know what? I'm giving a shout out to Pastor Dave Carlson right now. He always says this in the middle of stuff. Sometimes I think he visits black churches on Wednesday, and then he comes to Sunday service. I think he does, because he's been preaching. Like, if I close my eyes, I promise you, I can hear a black Baptist, a Pentecostal preacher. He's losing his mind. And he's got to explain it, because he's got a whole bunch of white people in his church. You know what he's got to say every time? I'm sorry if my eyebrows go down and my voice rises and I feel and I look a little aggressive. I'm sorry. I'm not mad. I'm just excited. He's got to explain all that. Guess what I'm not going to do? I'm not going to explain shit. Judge me by my fruit. If I have rotten fruit falling from my tree, judge me rotten. That's what the Bible says you're supposed to do. If what I'm doing, saying, is producing good fruit, then shut the hell up. Because it's not even me. It's Christ that lives in me, because I wouldn't care one way or another if any of it happened. Get yourself over there to Josiah Center on March 7th. And you can make excuses not to go if you want to, but the truth is that it's going to bless you. And if I told you that if you showed up at the Lexus dealer tomorrow at 9:30 in the morning and they were giving away 150 brand new Lexus cars, and if all you had to do is be there by 9:30, guess where you would be at 9:30 in the morning? Guess.
At the dealership.
You'd be at the Lexus dealership getting your brand new Lexus car. And this is more valuable than a brand new Lexus car. This is more valuable than that guy you wished you had. This is more valuable than that money you wished you made. This is valuable. This is victory. And women in particular need a role model for victorious living. See, men got a lot of them. Yeah, LeBron James, Tiger Woods, Muhammad Ali. I would say Michael Jackson, but I don't think he was a good role model. I'm sorry, I can't go there. But I mean, you know what I'm saying? We have the, you know, there's a lot of men, different things, you know. Women are kind of shy. I mean, there's not a lot of women role models. And the truth is a lot of you women are running to men. Now, I don't have nothing against Doug or Dave or Earl. I don't have nothing against none of them. But a lot of women are even leaving their husbands and running to men and hearing men tell them how to be a better woman. Guess what you shouldn't be doing? Listening to a man tell you how you should be a better woman. Guess why you shouldn't do that? Because if he knows how to be a better woman, you might want to check his gender card. He might be one of them cross-dressers or one of them bipolar genealogists, is whatever you call them, people that don't know what they who they are. Is that what they call them, genealogists?
No, I don't.
Genos, what they call them? Whatever, I can't think of it. But all I'm saying is this is an opportunity to step into hearing the voice of a woman talk about the struggles of a woman and being victorious as a woman, and it doesn't pertain a man. It doesn't pertain a man. Do you know how powerful it is? I would like Lori and Bambi and Brenda and Jennifer, I would like all of y'all to just wrap your mind around this. Her victory didn't depend on her relationship with a man. Her deliverance, her victory, was dependent on what she did by faith and her relationship with God. That's the masculine figure in this equation. Because no matter what Emily says, God is a man, masculine, and he's not a man, he's spirit, masculine, he's a father. Jesus is the son. His mom was a woman. Okay, I got that off my chest. Lighthouse Ministries. Lighthouse Ministry is a parachurch. Look it up. I'm not going to get into explaining that right now. Spiritual ministry intended to facilitate freedom to the world. To whom? God bless America? No. To the world. Wide bride of Christ. The bride of Christ is worldwide. There's going to be Pakistani, European, African, Ethiopian, indigenous Americans, Aborigines. The body of Christ is going to be so multiracial, multicultural. You're going to be, maybe you won't even want to go to, and maybe if you're a Trump fan, maybe you won't even want to go to heaven. There's going to be so many black people up there. Did I say that out loud?
That was your outside voice.
That was my outside voice? I'm sorry. She told me to be careful with my outside voice. We are men and women who believe God has the answer for believers who are experiencing spiritual conflicts that are overwhelming. I'm going to read this again for a friend of mine that's sitting over there. in the room. They're over there. Hey, how you doing? I'm going to read this for you. We are men and women who believe God has the answer for believers. That's people who are born again and saved by grace through faith, who are experiencing spiritual conflicts, comma, that are overwhelming them. Do you know that there's people right now that are born again, saved by grace, and even healed and restored, still suffering from overwhelming spiritual conflicts? Did you know that? Go to the first. Yeah, right there.
Page what?
Page 96.
Page 96.
Try to go to 96. Because that's the page I want. That'd be after 95. And right before 97. Give me your book, I'll help you. Give me your book, I'll help you. You ready?
Mm-hmm.
So that's 95. And that page right there?
It's 96.
Right there. They hid it between 99 and 30. Got it, baby?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Am I in the right book?
Yes, you are. I just thought we were starting at chapter. Never mind.
Okay, I want to read this. The reason why I want to read this is because it's important. Because there's an agenda. This book has an agenda. And if I don't tell you the agenda, and I start, you won't know how many people spent time, energy, effort, money, finances, resources into putting this together. And this is their mission statement. You ready? We are men and women, the people who developed this program, are men and women who believe God has the answer for believers. Do you believe God has the answer for believers? But who are experiencing spiritual conflicts that are overwhelming to them. So, if you're a believer and you've been delivered, sanctified, glorified, Holy Ghost filled, and you're still experiencing spiritual conflict that is overwhelming to you, this is for you. The ministry informally started out of a need. As a result, guess what the need was? I was part of this around between 89 and 91. I was part of the developing of this. Listen what people did. He sent paper, sheets of paper stapled together all over to people. And people got on board and helped each other, blessed each other, and said, what are some of the problems in your church, Pastor Danny Barnes? Calvary Worship Center, what are you doing? I'm saying, I've got people who love the Lord who still are addicted to pornography and cheat on their wife. And I know they love the Lord, they're saved by grace through faith, they're born again, but they still struggle with their sin nature. So is all of that was developed in churches from all over the country and probably all over the world? I wasn't there. I don't know that it came from all over the world. I know it came from most parts of the country of the United States. People said, believers are living in the same captive, in the same prison, as unbelievers. Maybe sometimes more. How can that be? How can that be? There was an in-depth study on spiritual warfare starting in Ephesians 6. But then you go from Genesis to Revelations. Guess what the Bible's for? Spiritual conflict. Guess who came against Eve in the garden? A demonic spirit, a voice, suggested to her, and she suggested to her husband. Guess what happened next? Cain killed Abel. A spiritual attack. But when you read those scriptures, do you give them, the devil, do you give him some responsibility in that? Well, what made Cain kill Abel? Well, what was it? And the Bible says, sin crouches at your door. evil crouches at your door. You're subject to a demonic attack if your countenance falls. And if you do well, won't you be appreciated? And if not, so you see what I'm saying? And then we can go on, and I don't want to. Then we can go on. We can go on to Noah building the ark. And people, we can go to Sodom and Gomorrah. They wanted to have sex with the angels so bad. Lot said, "Take my daughters; they're virgins. You can have them. Don't touch the angels." Dimwits said, "No, give us the men. Give us the angels. We're going to have sex with them." We learned something preparing this, Dan, especially. Me, as we went along, and I kept getting different drafts, we learned something, that there's been a demonic influence on this planet. The sons of God had sex with the daughters of men. If you go through the Bible, you'll find that every great leader, every man, every woman, every child, every prince, every princess, kill all the firstborn. From the beginning. So we had to design an avenue for at least believers to defend themselves against the demonic attack that Eve had in the garden. How should she have addressed that? Watch this. Did God really say? Watch how she answers. Watch. You ready? Did God really say? Watch. Okay, I'm going to say it one more time. Did God really say? Watch. Yep, he did. Yep. Did God really say? Yep.
Yep, he did.
Yep. That ended the whole damn thing. And then watch this. Adam comes along. He says, "Hey, Adam, come here, baby. I want you to try this fruit. Where'd you get it, honey?" "I got it off that tree. A serpent said I should try it." And you know what he should have said? "Baby, you don't lost your rabbit ass mind. If you think I'm eating from the tree that God told me not to eat from, I don't care how cute you are in a leaf. I'm not doing it. I'm not doing it." You see how quickly that could end? The same thing with Cain and Abel, the kids of Adam and Eve. They both burnt an offering. They both brought an offering to God. One was accepted. One was rejected. You know, the guy that accepted it, his was accepted. He should have done that humbly. Been blessed humbly. And the one that God didn't accept his gift should have been humble. Said, "Okay, I'll do better next time." But he listened to the demonic attack, saying that he wasn't worthwhile, he wasn't worthy, and that his brother's fault that he didn't provide a good sacrifice. So I'm going to kill my brother. Well, you see, can you see the spiritual attack? Can you see the demonic attack even in that? And then you go on and on and on and on and on. And then Adam, and then Noah and the ark, and then the Sodom and Gomorrah, and then Lot having sex with his daughters, and then the split between Abraham and Lot. And every part of it, Moses bringing them out of Egypt into the promised land, and the spies come back and says, "Oh, we're never going to be able to do that." Really? Really? You're never going to be able to do what God said you're easily going to do? Well, that's a demonic attack. I could go on and on and on and on, but I don't want to go on and on and on and on, because I want to. Why did Peter deny Christ? It was a demonic attack. Why did Judas sell him for 30 pieces of silver? It says Satan entered into Judas and he went and did the thing. Why did Thomas doubt? Why did they all leave Jesus and go back to their old lifestyle until Jesus was resurrected and came back and says, "Come on, you big idiot, you damn fool. Let me take you back over here, get you back online. Now go wait for the powering of the Holy Spirit." Every one of them betrayed him. Every one of them. I don't think the women did. I'm not sure what Mary, his mom did, or Mary Magdalene, but all the disciples, all the apostles, all of them, they said they loved him, but really they loved what he could do for them. And then after his resurrection, now that he died for them and came back and proved, they didn't want to just believe it, he had to prove who he was, then they were willing to lay down their life. Until then, they went back to their old life. After his resurrection, then they were willing to lay down their life, and they did. They were martyred for the kingdom of God. All right, ready? The ministry informally started, I already read that part. As a result, Lighthouse has now grown into an organization ministry with scheduled opportunities, meetings, and hundreds of thousands of people every year from every walk of life and every economic standard and every denomination. This ministry has never sought publicity. I give this ministry more publicity really than it ever even wanted. They're quiet, and I'm not. I think it's important that this gets out. But an ever-increasing number of delivered believers have formed a united testimony that is difficult to refute. Reverend Sally Clark Barnes is going to give her victorious testimony, and there's victorious testimonies that are available, and yours is one. Just the fact that you're going to make it to the conference is a victory. All right. The ministry has grown only by the testimony of those who have been set free. That's by word of mouth. That's how this continues to grow. I've never seen them advertised anywhere. Our ministry is not only with individuals, but with opportunities to train and equip pastors, missionaries, and lay people beyond informational awareness. We also teach post-deliverance Bible studies for the delivered believer. Our endeavor is to bring people from the foxhole to the front line. Do you know how many of you have been spending your entire Christian life in a foxhole? Do you know what a foxhole is? A place that I'm never in. A foxhole, ask Alex Paul what a foxhole is. A foxhole is a place where you hide until the enemy is done doing whatever he wants to. That's where you hide, is in a foxhole. I'm a frontline soldier. I don't do foxholes. I don't even do church buildings. Do you know how easy it was for me, ask Lori, do you know how easy it was for me to preach from a pulpit with a church full of people who were writing me checks for $60,000, $80,000, $100,000? You know how easy that was for me? That's easy ministry. Victorious spiritual warfare ministry is watching little Susie pray for the first time in her life. What's her name? Wanda? Yolanda? What's the...
Tawanda?
No.
Oh.
What's the girl that got up on a wheelchair?
Oh, I'm not sure.
Yeah. Okay, we were talking about her all day. Just this little old lady down Dry Street. She got out of a wheelchair.
Rhonda.
She ran around. She got out of a wheelchair. That's victorious spiritual warfare. When somebody's crippled and then they're not, that's victorious spiritual warfare. When little Susie, who used to jump on my car, I had to slam on the brakes to get her off. She hung on to my doorknob and my mirrors and stood on my running boards. And when she gets delivered and a light comes on in her eyes and she can see plain and clear, easily, that God is alive and well and loves her, that's victorious spiritual. And I wouldn't have gotten that in a pulpit. I wouldn't have gotten that in a pew. I wouldn't have gotten that in a coffee shop. I wouldn't have gotten that, not that. All right, ready? Did you want to say something?
No.
We also teach post-deliverance. I already read that. Our endeavor is to bring people from the foxhole to the front line to recover ground for the kingdom of God. This is important for Dan and me. It's nice that Reverend Sally and I are recovering ground for the kingdom of God. Guess what's better? When you join us. And guess what's better than that? When people you know join you, when you join us. Guess what's better than that? When people they know them, who know you, who know us, join us. And then we have an army that's marching across this planet, all across the planet, bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ and setting captives free. That's my job, and I'm good at it. And you don't even have to like it. I don't give a shit. All right, ready? The ministry does not necessarily represent the official position of the Christian and Missionary Alliance. All right, which allows freedom on controversial subjects on which committed evangelistic traditionally take various positions. So when you have a position on the Trinity or rapture, we don't get involved in them conversations. You want to know why? Because it has absolutely nothing to do with you being victorious in your walk with the Lord. Does it matter whether there was 30,000 or 25,700 soldiers that marched around Jericho? Doesn't matter? Not to the kingdom? No, it doesn't matter. Was it a fish or a man? Does that matter? Doesn't get you into heaven or hell. Doesn't make you victorious If it doesn't make you, if it doesn't have redemptive value, if you aren't delivered, if you aren't stronger because of the information you're getting, then I call it piss theology, and it doesn't matter. All right. And controversial subjects. I have a ministry where I want drug addicts, sex offenders, alcoholics, robbers, rapers, murderers. That's the church I want. I want notorious sinners in my building. That's what I want. So there's that. And a lot of churches, you know, shy away from that. We stand soundly under the doctrinal statement of faith of the Christian. We purpose that we have written the Lighthouse Procedure Manual. So, Lighthouse Procedure Manual, subject to examination and change. And the reason why I like that is because there was a time when Dan said that you can cast Satan into hell. And I wrote him a letter and said, how can you cast Satan into the pits of hell when Jesus cast him into the pigs? And hell, there's not time for that. Next thing I know, there's a revision of the spiritual warfare manual that's been deleted. The Lighthouse Ministry team is constantly learning more about what our Lord Jesus Christ taught and practiced concerning deliverance. We submit this manual to the body of Christ, that's all of us, to be used as our master sees fit. All right. I've already been on there. I've been on there too long now, right? I got on there at 7.
Yeah.
So, am I still okay?
You're okay for a little bit.
All right. The light, because it's late, I think that I've been on here for 2 hours. Because I can't tell time for one thing. Can't read and write for another thing.
But that would be a good
place to stop?
Yes.
All right, I'm going to because I got other things I want. And then that way we'll be on 97. Honey, 97?
Yes, 97.
90, because I know you like to write that down.
Yes.
Because usually you tell me where we're at.
I'm going.
You didn't know that I was going to do that.
No, I actually turned my book to the
front of the first
page. Yes, and then I got confused there. So, okay. Page 97 next time.
Thou shalt remind me. That's Kingdom Couple. I was with Pastor Tomas yesterday. Mighty man of God. He has a different church than I go to. He just opened a church. It's called Pain Reliever. If you live in the vicinity of
the east side.
York and Pain and
Geranium.
Geranium.
Mm-hmm.
If you live near and around that area, I mean, that's a pretty powerful ministry. And I would encourage you to give Pastor Tomas a once-over look. I would encourage you to do that. Mighty man of God. And then there's if you like more ritzy, Bishop Earl Gilchrist is over at Lighthouse Ministries. No, Rivers of Life. Rivers of Life on Summit. I'm sorry. This is Lighthouse Ministry. Rivers of Life. And I strongly suggest if you live in the Capitol Hill area, around the University to Grand area, from right around the Cathedral to Summit. In that area, that's a good place to go to church. You know, pretty black, which I like, black churches. But I'm not telling you if you're white, don't go there. Just don't be surprised if there's a bunch of black people there. So, and if you go to Josiah Center, which Pastor Dave Carlson is the man of God that I'm standing down to, he might be my pastor after a couple of days. We're supposed to have a meeting with him, and I don't. And Pastor James Tribble has been my senior pastor for 20 plus years. So he's in St. Cloud; he's not easily accessible. So I do need a senior pastor, and I may never have another bishop. Somebody told me the other day, Bishop Messenger wanted me to go see what was that bishop's name? That they told you? I can't remember. Ivy Hillier. Bishop Ivy Hillier. So I may fly out and talk to him because I should have a bishop. And Jimmy asked me the other day, what's the difference between a pastor and a bishop? If I'm your pastor, you call me pastor. If I've licensed you to pastor, you call me bishop. I'm the pastor to pastors. As a pastor, I pastor you and fellowship and congregation. So that I hope that explains it. Pentecostal Church of God and EWEMI World Ministries are the two licenses I still hold. So it doesn't mean shit. Bottom line is, I'm tougher than you, so what are you going to do? Huh? You can't whoop me. That was just a joke. So, I was just kidding. Alright. Listen. People say they love Jesus, and they want people to believe that they do. And Jack and I got into a conversation the other day about how everybody loves Jesus. And I don't believe it. Because you'll know if you love Jesus, not because you say it, but because how you behave. What do you do? What do you say? How do you live? What is your goal? What is your purpose? What is your assignment? And if you, when you pray to Jesus, the conversation consists of, would you do this for me? Would you help me with this? Would you provide me with this? Can you fix this? If that's what your conversation consists of, then you don't love Jesus. You want Jesus to love you enough to give you what you want, and Jesus wants you to love him enough to give him what he died for, which is your soul, which is your life. You want him to be your Lord and Savior, not your provider and your feel-gooder. You can go to the doctors for that. Listen, I'm trying to help you here. And if I'm not helping you, hang up. Because this stuff is what I needed for me to go from being a raping, robbing, murderer, killer with on death row to the man that, you know, you see here before you today. You get to talk shit about Danny Barnes and then wake up in the morning. That should be a miracle to you right there. This is it, folks. Women. Men are welcome to go. So if you want to take your girl on a nice date, this is a good place. Women on Fire Ministries presents Reverend Sally Clark Barnes, March 7th at 3:30. So when you get done figuring out how many different reasons there are that you can't go, make up your mind to be there. And then act like you are going to get a brand new Mercedes-Benz if you made it there. Because what you're going to get is more valuable than a brand new Mercedes-Benz. So I love you, and I really do. And it's going to be fun the next couple weeks. I don't know how long it's going to take. How long do you think it'll take me to get through the next one if I act like I got sense?
Ooh.
2 months?
Yeah, probably
6 weeks.
We'll say 16 sessions, if that.
All right.
At the most.
So 16, 3, how many times is 6, 3 going to 16?
Well, that'd be 4 a week, right?
Right. Okay. So we're going to get this done.
Or 4 a month, I mean.
All right. So that's
I don't know. I'm confused now.
All right. So that we're going to get this done. And when we get this done, we're going to do 2 a week, Monday and Wednesday. We're going to start at 7 o'clock. So then somebody that's better at math than me,
2, 4,
figure out how many.
That'd be 2 months.
That's all right. So yeah, 2 months.
2 months.
Yeah. 16. So 2 months. We're going to do this for 2 months. And we're going to we're going to get this. And your husband is going to be delivered by your chastened behavior. Your relationship with your children is going to be better because of victorious spiritual warfare. Your wife is going to love you more and be more concerned about the things of God than she is about the things of man after we're done. And then I want you to share it. Don't think about that a lot right now. Then I want you to take this message into a small group. Have two or three people come over to your house or your apartment. And then you teach people what I taught you. And let them get free. And then each one of them have a small group in their house. And then you got another five or seven people that will get delivered and free from the bondage of the sin nature and the being held captive by demonic spirits. Now I'm going to say this again because I'm not sure anybody got it. The attack on the garden came from a demonic spirit, the serpent. The attack on Cain and Abel was a demonic spirit. The attack on Noah was a demonic spirit. The attack on the Tower of Babel was a demonic spirit. The attack on Sodom and Gomorrah was a demonic spirit. All through the Bible, if you read it, the work of God, the things of God, has always been confronted by a demonic attack. And the thing about it is, and I do this on purpose, I'll throw stuff at people so they learn how to behave under attack. Huh, Reverend?
Oh, yeah.
You got to learn how to behave under attack. You got to learn because you have to stand. It says stand, and then what? Stand. Again, it says stand again. Stand. All right, I'm done. You got anything, Reverend?
I don't.
She's been going all day with this, preparing for this. So if she missed a couple cues today, don't hold it against her. Ready? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever, and ever and ever, and ever and ever, and ever and ever, and ever and ever and ever. Amen. God bless you, and good night.
Amen. Good night.